Oh boy. Good evening. Welcome to the May 18th, 2015, Harwich Board of Selectmen's meeting. We went into executive session at 6:15, and at that time we talked the negotiation position on two properties that we're in the process of, we hope, purchasing, the Hull property and the Sufton property. We went out of a session, I guess, a couple minutes ago, and now we're back in open session. I'd like to open with a Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Anyone, weekly briefing?
Mr. Chairman, weekly briefing I would like to bring up if I could.
Okay.
I'm going to use the other mic if that's okay with you.
Is that because you're afraid I'm going to hit you if you stay here?
What's that?
You're afraid I'm going to hit you if you stay here?
Yeah, I am. I am. Just bear with me for a few minutes. It's come to the board's attention, particularly the three members that are left after this evening, that the two of us are departing after tonight. And that's Mr. McManus after a number of years, 12 years. And Mr. Chairman, I know you're looking forward to retiring after this evening. And we all know that you have put in, both of you, very significant service to this town. And on behalf of the Board of Selectmen, and particularly the citizens of the town of Harwich, we have a little appreciation for each of you. And that's why I wanted to stand up here, because this way you can't throw it at me. Let's see. Maybe somebody can help me here. Just want to get the other one out. So Ed, we'll do you first. This is a plaque.
Sounds terrible.
It's kind of neat because the gavel comes off, so about this. Very handy, right? Town of Harwich, Board of Selectmen, 2004 to 2015. That's 12 years. And two times as chairman, and presented to Edward J. McManus, and has a quote in here, Mr. Chair, so since you were chairman. So Ed, I'm going to just give this to you. We're going to let you guys speak in a minute, I suppose, or maybe at the end. One thing I'll say is boards of selectmen and individuals on the board come and go, but it's always about working as a team. And I think, you know, you guys have worked very well, certainly before I got back on the board, as a team with everybody. And certainly I appreciate the efforts for the last several years. And, you know, we don't always agree, but that's okay. That's what it's all about. So, Larry, I have a plaque for you as well. Again, it's the new and improved, remove the gavel type. Town of Harwich Board of Selectmen 2009 to 2015, and chairman twice. Again, both of you did chairman twice. Thank you for doing that. And presented to Larry G. Ballantyne, again, Mr. Chair. So thank you for your service. You will be missed, and especially by the rest of us pretty soon. But we will make up for it, and we expect to see you here before us on a regular basis. And don't lose touch with us, please. But thank you for your service.
Thank you very much. I'm not going to, Ed, do you want to make any comments?
Well, you know, it's been a distinct honor and a privilege to be a selectman in this town for the last 11 or 12 years. and I want to thank the citizens for putting their faith in me for those times, the four elections. As I think you know, I'll still be in town and still be involved, but this past 11 years has been very rewarding for me personally. And I hope rewarding for the town and its citizens. Thank you.
I guess I can only agree with what Ed said, and I guess we have Larry Cole and other ex, so we can comment as well. But it's been my great privilege, and I've enjoyed almost all of it. And I've really enjoyed meeting and having discussions with so many people in Harwich. It's an amazing town, an amazing group of individuals, and just look around our volunteers. We have so much expertise in town. It's been a great privilege. So, and when I announced that I wasn't running again, a lot of people came to me and assumed I was dying. And I'm actually very healthy. I just decided I would do something else for a while. But thanks again. Very much appreciated. Thank you all. Anyone else for a weekly briefing? Larry?
If there are no department heads working tight to go first. Well, congratulations to the two of you. And let me tell you that it is not hard to stay away from here on Monday nights after you retired. And there are lots of other things to do. And I appreciated very much having the pleasure and privilege of serving with three of you who are currently. And it was delightful to be replaced by Linda. Last week, in your packets, you should have received a copy of a note that went from the Cape and Vineyard Electric Co-op to the directors, notifying us and the towns that American Capital Energy had filed with the Barnstable Superior Court an amendment to remove what are called the reach and apply defendants from their lawsuit with Clean Focus and Redwood Solar, which means the towns and CVEC are out of that fight. I had not previously heard what the term reach and apply defendants, and I looked it up, and here's an example. A owes B and B owes C, then C can go after A and leave B out. Well, they were coming after us, that would have been left out. The example being used by the attorney on Google was that last year, in a civil suit of some kind involving Aaron Hernandez, the plaintiffs went after Bob Kraft and the Patriots. That was an example of going after the reach and apply. In other words, they go where the money is. Mm-hmm. Anyway, in addition to that, I've asked Chris to distribute to you a chart that shows through February of this year, revenues and costs, and more than that, actually, kilowatt hours, net metering credits, PPA cost, and net revenue. And you'll notice right away that it looks like Harwich's total is equal to that of the whole of round one of CVEC, but of course there's a different scale up at the top than that there is in the middle of the page. Let me just put some numbers on those. The net metering credits were a little more than $390,000. The PPA cost was a little more than $177,000. And our net revenue was not quite $213,000. And that is incomplete. It turns out that the PPA cost and net revenue for December for Harwich were missing at the time this chart was prepared. And that's symptomatic of the fact that there are still problems with the data acquisition system. I've described those before. It's essentially, we're still not able to verify that we're getting the same numbers, that is, CVEC is getting the same numbers that now Eversource is getting. I want to say never fail. what I hope to have by June, and the next CVEC meeting is on the 11th of June, and I hope to have then another up-to-date through May, or at least April, with the numbers for December included. So that means net revenue is a little larger than is shown here. Just some other CVEC news. The last meeting was on the 16th of April. That afternoon in the mail, I received your letter of appointment. I could have attended as a member of the public, but I went for a long run instead. Anyway, I've read the minutes, and things that are of possible interest are there are problems with the accounting system for those small projects that are being reimbursed on what's called a cash-out system. where instead of getting a total net metering lump in the aggregate like we do and applying it to our total bill, they're actually having to allocate down to the individual accounts. Why, back then, NSTAR, it just created an accounting nightmare. We've had to hire some consultants to help straighten it out. Payments are being made on time, but it's not clear because of the data problems that the precise amounts are going to the right parties. Again, I hope to be able to report in June that that's all okay. Otherwise, on the institutional front, Mashpee is no longer a member. I think they had no projects and no prospects of a project. There's a new director from Dennis, and there's a vacancy in Sandwich, from which the previous director for months and months and months didn't come, and there evidently was some misunderstanding between him and the board in Sandwich about who their representative was, but they're going to replace someone who's interested in attending. Other than that, because round two is running a little bit behind schedule and is not generating much income yet, and because there's still an interest on the part of all the parties to disconnect CVEC from relying on the county for fiduciary and administrative support, the CVEC is thinking about coming to the round one project parties, which includes us, to talk with about possibly starting the mill adder. It hasn't been discussed in depth yet. I just wanted to give you a heads up on that. You perhaps realize that my view would be that kind of charge ought to be a flat rate charge. It's not a function of usage. That's all I have.
Okay, thank you, Larry. Does anyone have questions, comments? But Barry? And Larry, thanks for, Larry?
Yes.
Thanks for stepping up and joining the committee again for us.
Well, thanks for having me back. I understand it means you're desperate, but.
How do you follow that, Barry?
I can't. I can never follow him up. I would like to say the same thing that Larry did and congratulate and thank Mr. McManus and Mr. McBallentine for all the work they've done and the support that my committee, Utility and Energy Conservation, has received and continues to receive. I know that the board received documents some time ago in relation to the aggregation plan of the Cape Light Compact. I just would like to publicly acknowledge the fact that it has been approved by the Attorney General and is in effect. And if it all it boils down to is that I made a presentation here well over a year ago as to what there was a proposed revisions to the aggregation plan, which is the document that the Cape Light Compact uses to organize and to operate. And really, I said the changes were in housekeeping and a little bit in reporting that hadn't been done. The net result after everything is done and this is approved is that's what the approved document really is. All of the discussion about whether there is illegal taxes and things like that being generated by the Cape Light Compact, I have to say, hopefully is gone by the board. The plan is what was proposed. If you would like me to appear before the board to talk some more in the detail, I'd be happy to do that. I just want to publicly say it is in effect, and I'm happy that that's done. I'm also happy that Larry's CVEC project is generating some real great revenues for the town.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Barry. Other weekly briefings? Public comment?
Larry, a question. I'd like to make a comment about an editorial from the Cape Cod Times.
I think now's the appropriate time.
I'd like to make a comment on an editorial from this Saturday's Cape Cod Times entitled Telling the Truth, in a letter to the Chronicle entitled Who's the Boss in Harwich. I merely want to suggest that everyone read the Times article to become familiar with the state regulation currently in place relative to political statements. I also bring up the particular letter to the editor to deal with issues of fact. Obviously, everyone is entitled to their own opinion, but they are apparently not entitled to make up their own facts. Last year at the 2014 town meeting, we ran into a situation where a number of petitioned articles were written in a way that forced these articles to be considered advisory only. The steps immediately taken to help out in this situation by the Board of Selectmen included posting on the town's website a document which suggested how best to develop petition articles that would work. The key point is that the town administrator would help, and the article would be reviewed by town's legal counsel to ensure that it was done in an appropriate legal manner. Please note that the Board of Selectmen cannot change a petition article. We cannot even correct spelling errors. That is why the petitioner has to carry on the review himself or herself. The next step was to mention on several times during Board of Selectmen meetings what was on the website and strongly suggest a meeting with the town administrator on the subject. Yes, as the letter stated, the charter is key and must be followed. However, as you know, because of the lack of clarity in a number of sections, we often have to get advice from council on what should be done. This happens often enough, as a matter of fact, that we've appointed a charter review group with a prime task of reviewing the current charter to make sure that each point is clearly written. The Board of Selectmen does get to set goals and policies, and even gets to review the performance of the town administrator. We also get to vote our position on and whether some articles should be brought to town meeting, except for petitioned articles. The Board of Selectmen, however, has no control over judgments relative to regulations of building, health, conservation, ZBA, or the planning board. It is the combination of town meeting decisions and the vote following at the ballot box that runs the town. Here is where the authorization for budget and article approval and funding authorization lies. The Board of Selectmen cannot purchase, sell, or change the current use for town-owned property without a vote by the residents. So the answer to the question of who is boss is simple. The residents who care enough to participate in town meeting and at the ballot box and to perform as members of the numerous town committees, or who even attend and comment at Board of Selectmen meetings and other public meetings. That's where the real power is. That is who's really boss. I'd like to be able to stop there, but unfortunately I have to go on for one more paragraph. There is another comment that has to be made about the letter that was written to the newspaper. It is either slanderous or indicates a violation of the state's ethics violation. So if the letter writer has proof that an attempt was made to bribe town council to rule in a certain way on the petition articles, that proof needs to be given to the town administrator so that an investigation of this action can be undertaken. If not, a letter of apology probably is warranted to both town council and the Board of Selectmen. Why would I bring this up tonight? Well, our elections are tomorrow, and I would hope people would go to the polls and vote, because your votes are very, very important, particularly in a town the size of Harwich. You count a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Angelo. And I was reminded by Ann and Sandy earlier this week, be sure that I reinforce that. Please go and vote tomorrow. You know, we've missed Ann and Sandy. They came and left. But and I forgot to thank them for all their help, which we couldn't survive up here without the administrative support. And occasionally, they're even polite to us, actually, which is, when she reads this, I'm going to be in trouble, Chris. Because they're always very professional, very helpful. Mm-hmm. I'd like to make, if I may, a quick public comment, and that is just an update on the wastewater 208 plan. I had a meeting last week with a collaborative, and a couple of things I thought was interesting. I think probably most people have been keeping track of this the so-called Section 208, which is the our wastewater plan that's been mandated by now a court settlement. And the Cape Cod Commission has been, with a lot of people's input from across the Cape, have been working on this. they're on schedule to present their report to DEP and then the EPA by June 15th. And so that's good. Their deadline internally was a commission to finish their work June 1st, and they'll submit it to June 15th. EPA still says they're on schedule to complete their review by September 15th. And that means also that the judge will make a judgment at that time. As I think you all know, we've thrown around the term settlement. This is not really a settlement. What the judge did is stay the agreement, the lawsuit by the Conservation Law Foundation, rather than come after the EPA and DEP, and actually at some point they threatened to come after the towns and individual homeowners. That's been stayed. I think our guess is that at the 9/15, September 15th deadline, they will continue that stay for some time. Your guess is as good as mine. 2 or 3 years or so on to be sure that whatever our wastewater plans are, that we're actually going to do it. Because that's their fear, is that we'll file a nice plan like many of us have done business strategy plans, then file it and never look at it again. Their fear is that we'll put a plan in place, we want to be sure we continue it. The other thing I wanted to mention that I'm pleased about is a lot of discussion throughout the past several months has been the definition of a wastewater management authority. And we've been concerned whether that would be a Cape-wide authority, which many of us in the towns didn't quite like that much. We wanted to keep our town responsibility to that. Some other type of regional districts responsibility. In the end, the commission's going to propose, and I think they'll accept it, that the wastewater management authorities will be the individual towns. That means we can, and all the towns can develop our own comprehensive wastewater management plans. And as long as you put that forward and take steps to follow the plan, we should be okay. The last comment I would make, I'm also pleased about, because occasionally we've worried about Cape Cod Commission and the county actually had, not to pick on you, but taking it, because you're actually on our side on this one, taking authority away from the towns rather than providing support. The Cape Cod Commission now has several task groups set out now to provide support to the towns. One is they're looking at templates and how to form regional agreements, this type of stuff. Now, we're ahead of many of them because we're already working with Chatham, first with the schools, now with Muddy Creek, and soon with the, hopefully work out a sharing of the sewer plant. They're also looking at templates on how to allocate watersheds when two or more towns share one watershed, how you allocate costs and so on, as supporting. They're not dictating that to us, but support of that. Another issue that comes up is, and they're giving some thought and providing some guidance on how we prioritize. You know, for instance, where Chatham was ahead of us, we're ahead of Dennis. How do we work that into an overall plan to make sense? So they have three or four, and there's probably a couple more, but they're actually getting together, hopefully as many experts as they can come back and then provide us with some guidance, templates, make our lives easier, complying with this lawsuit so we can stay out of trouble in clean our harbor. So I'm pleased. I think it's moving in the good direction, but I just wanted to give that update to everyone. Is there any? Stay tuned. Peter?
I will just remind everybody that, you know, we went to that kickoff meeting, whatever it was, the meeting that was, I don't know, 6 weeks ago or something up in Hyannis, and the Conservation Law Foundation executive who was there, the attorney, was asked the question, you know, how do you know you're doing it good enough, or how do you know you're making enough progress? How do you know you're on schedule? Whose schedule? And basically the answer was, well, if you're not doing what we think you should do, we'll file some more lawsuits. I mean, that was my impression. There is no thing that says Harwich by this date must do this, and then by this date must do this. It's every plan for every town in a best effort, I think, to show that you're going forward. And certainly we've done that with Muddy Creek and some, you know, some other things that we're doing. But that part of it, to me, is still fraught with danger, because you got a Conservation Law Foundation at any time they feel like it can just go back to court and say the town of Harwich is not moving fast enough, whatever that means.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments, questions? Larry?
Just a clarification. I think the 208 plan requires, in the case of watersheds that are shared by more than one community, that the Wastewater Management Authority be composed jointly and not of the involved towns. It can't be a single town. In the case of our case, we've got four watersheds that are entirely within the town.
Yeah,
and you've got Pleasant Bay.
That was the direction we thought they were going, but that's not the direction they're going to submit to sell the suit. They're going to argue that with our local, why shake up local government to the extent that would require, and have the towns be the Wastewater Management Authority, with the requirement that we work with our neighboring towns as they're supposed to cover the whole watershed. So we'll, if this goes forward and the judge, EPA and the judge agrees on it, we will still maintain our control, but with the caveat that we have to show how we're working with neighboring towns. But you're right, a few months ago there was a thought that we'd have some joint committees across towns, but they've thrown that out as being too complicated. And I know my argument during part of that discussion was, you know, many things you have a choice, complex and simple. I like simple better. And they've that's where they are. Okay, I just wanted to bring, any other public comment? Yes, Bob.
Will the town actually vote to have public sewer at any time? And my other question was, have they ever given any thought to putting the recycled water on the golf course? Because it seems like that's what a lot of towns do, because it's a good place for use a lot of water, and it's a huge piece of land.
The answer to the first question is easier, because any next step in the water management plan itself will have to be voted on by town meeting. Yeah, you know, what we're trying to do is get prepared for that going forward. The second one is on the golf course. I'm not sure we considered that per se, because that'd be an extremely expensive option for us at the moment. So it's I suppose you could do that, but it'd be a very expensive option. No, but you have to pipe it there and collect it and stuff. But, Ed?
I think it's similar in length,
but. Well, they do that a lot in California, where they have to water their golf courses 365 days a year. But, you know, in during the winter when we don't water, what do you do with the wastewater if you don't have another system of recharging it? Build a reservoir someplace? We could, but I'm not sure that's a...
I would just comment on that, is that, you know, what we're trying to do is position ourselves to move forward. And it doesn't mean other options won't be considered in the future as they come up. But that's where we are at the moment. Anything else on 208?
Thanks.
Okay. Ed, do you want to go to consent agenda?
Mr. Chair, I'd like to present the consent agenda and move the recommended actions thereon, including approve Chapter 90 project request, confirm appointment of Susan Kerr as administrative assistant in the Treasurer Collector's Office as recommended, approve common victualler license renewal for Perks, approve weekday entertainment license renewal for Perks, and approve request for assistance from the Caleb Chase Fund, and I'd like to separate out number F.
Good.
Okay.
Second.
Is there a second? Any discussions on A through E? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Approved. Ed, you want to?
I'd rather not make a motion on this item.
Well, I think I'd like to, we have something in our, we have some backing in our packet, but maybe we need an brief explanation on this.
Yes, we found that the The interview subcommittee is made up of two members of the Board of Selectmen, and we post our meetings. It's handled by the town administrator staff. We found that this meeting did not get properly posted. The administrative staff has apologized to both of us about 200 times, but something happened in the transmission. It didn't properly get posted. So therefore, to be appropriate to open meeting law, we are rescinding those appointments. We will be meeting with those people again this Wednesday, Angelo?
Yes.
This Wednesday at 4:30. The meeting has been properly posted, and we'll go through this again. But just to make sure that open meeting law is followed, it wasn't properly posted, so we have to rescind. And the fact that it wasn't properly posted wasn't found out until afterwards. So that's the rationale for it.
Okay. You want to move then to accept?
I move that we accept the rescinding these appointments for the reason stated.
Second. Peter, do you have a comment?
No.
Okay. Is any discussion for anyone? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
It's Gary.
Abstain.
Next are the public hearings, and I'm reminded after last week to be sure that I ask you to read the public hearing announcement.
Mr. Chair, the Harwich Board of Selectmen will hold a public hearing on Monday, May 18th, 2015, no earlier than 6:30 p.m. in the Don B. Griffin Room located at Town Hall, 732 Main Street, Harwich, for the purpose of reviewing proposed fee amendments relative to short-term dockage fees. All members of the public having an interest in this topic are cordially invited to attend the public hearing and provide information and testimony relevant to this issue.
Okay, it's open, and I guess, Chris, you looks like you're gonna turn it over to John.
Yep.
I'm working through the town administrator to be sure we do this right. John? Mr. Rendon.
Yes, sir. John Rendon, Harbor Master. I'm proposing a fee increase in the short-term tie-up rates. Just real quickly, a short-term tie-up means that if somebody wants to come into Sacquetucket Harbor and they want to come in for an hour or up to a maximum of 3 hours, they get charged an hourly rate based upon their boat size. And we have quite a few that come in throughout the summer. Many of them come in and go have lunch at Brack's, or they come in because they know somebody there in the harbor to visit, or they want to go in town. And right now, for the majority of boats that come in, we're charging $5 an hour for them to dock their boat and go off for an hour and then come back. The regulation, there are three categories currently. Boats that are up to 23 feet in length pay $5 an hour. 24 through 30 pay $7 an hour, and over 36 and over pay $8 an hour. The concept of short-term tie-up is a great it's a great benefit that I encourage we continue to do, but for $5 an hour, it takes quite a bit of effort on my staff to make this happen. For one, somebody comes in the harbor and they call us on the radio and say, hey, I'd like to get a slip for a couple of hours or for an hour. And so, one, we need to make sure we're by the radio all the time, which we do regardless, so that's not a big deal. But we have to go through our marina map and find slips that are available and that will be available for the term that they're coming into. And then most people who are coming into Sacquetucket Harbor don't know the harbor, so a lot of our guys then go out on the docks, direct them into the slip, help them tie up, and then they go have lunch or whatever they're going to do. And I mean, we're available to do that, but it's an effort for $5 an hour. And I just think that that rate needs to be increased a bit, to kind of pay for, you know, the effort that it takes to make this thing happen. I went to the Waterways Committee last month and made a proposal that we do a 2-hour period only, not a 1-hour, because if most people go to Brax, and you know how busy Brax is in the summer, and very seldom do people come and pay an hour, but very seldom do they come back within that hour. I mean, it's just, you know, it's a timely process. And so I'm suggesting that we go to a 2-hour period, and that we break up the vessel classification into two categories instead of three. Up to 35 feet is one category, 35 foot and over is another category. And they can pay for a 2-hour period, and if they stay beyond 2 hours, or if they wanted to stay beyond 2 hours, then we charge them the daily transient rate that is already defined in our Appendix B, which is $1.75 a foot for the day for a vessel up to 35 feet and $2.50 for a larger boat. I think most people come within that 2-hour period, so we would be encompassing the majority of folks who come into the harbor. And my suggestion when I went to Waterways was that we make that 2-hour a $15 for that 2-hour period for boats up to 35 feet, and a $20 rate for the boats in the higher category for that 2-hour period. The Waterways unanimously agreed to support the rate increase. However, they thought the rate should be higher than what I've suggested, so they suggested for that 2-hour period for the lower category $20 and $30 for that for the higher category. So that's what I'm looking at, and that's what I'm recommending, is what the Waterways voted on. Okay. If there's any questions?
I just have one question, John. And that is a significant increase in the fee for this transient rate. Is, I gather from the way you've approached this, and you know the time involved, and is that your the objective here is not so much to raise, it's not to raise revenue, it's to lower the demand for transient slips into a manageable level. Is that
well? I think it's
true.
I think it's twofold. I mean, I think when you consider. One, I don't think many people come for an hour. They pay for an hour, but they stay beyond an hour. Okay, so that's one point. My recommendation of $15 for a 2-hour period, really, when you look at it, if they were paying for a 2-hour period at $5 an hour, that'd be $10. I'm recommending 15. It's a $5 increase, not a significant increase, but it more reflects, I think, the time that they're actually staying. So I think it's a couple things. One, the effort that it takes for us to manage that process, and two, it raises revenue.
Yeah. No, I got that. I guess where I was thank you, John.
Sure.
I was going more towards to the extent that it does decrease the demand for that. If you overshoot that and you find people aren't taking advantage of it, will you reevaluate this next year?
Sure.
You always have, you know, if you overshoot, then I just want to be sure you're going to relook at it.
Right. I mean, we certainly can, and I can tell you kind of where we're at compared to previous years. I personally don't think that it'll decrease the amount of people who come in. I don't think it's that significant of a rate. I could be wrong, but we certainly can monitor it.
Okay. Peter?
I guess, John, with the current setup of, you know, so much per hour, I just sort of envision all these alarm clocks on all these boats and your crew running around trying to reset the alarm clocks. It seems like a nightmare logistically to me. The 2-hour thing makes sense to me the way you're describing it, because I do believe most people do go over to Brax. I mean, not just coming there to buy fuel or something, and, you know, they go to Brax, I believe. So my question would be, how do these fees or this fee structure compare with other harbors on the Cape?
I don't know. I haven't gone out and reached out. I know I received some information from Mr. Hart, who suggested that some towns don't even charge for that short-term tie-up period. I haven't done that research. I know what we are currently doing, and you know, I don't want to be heavy-handed in this, so I don't you know, my staff don't require that they leave a license with us or they leave their keys with us, or, I mean, I want it to be a welcoming environment. I want to support it as we can. But I also recognize that I think we're short there, you know, because $5 an hour and then people stay beyond that, I think we need to address that.
I think you're telling us with limited staff that this is more a nuisance than
it's
really worth.
Is.
And so it's worth, from your standpoint, it's worth to jack the fee a little bit, so at least you're getting something back for the town, if you will, for the aggravation, although you want to be welcoming, no doubt about it.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say it's a nuisance or aggravation. I mean, it takes some management, is really how I'd like to term it, because, I mean, we love to see people come to the harbor, and I, you know, many people do go to Brax, and I'd like to continue that. I think that's a great service to our public, but I
know
think
I
we're
was,
off the mark.
Coming back on a boat with our friend Mr. Patterson, in which someone was in his slip, and it was a bit of a management issue at the time.
Right, I was there, I remember, and I had to move him over. Yes, sir, I do remember.
Okay, Angela?
Another question. The people who are coming in for these slips, do they tend to be residents of Harwich, or are they people from other places?
I think you get all kinds. Many people come over from Bass River. We seem to get a lot of people, you know, who are coming from Bass River or Hyannis. I think we do get some people who come over from Allen Harbor or, you know, that are local. I think it's a mix, but many are outside of Harwich.
Okay, thank you. Ed, do you have a...
I think, personally, with Sacquatucket Harbor and the nearness of Brax, there aren't really a whole lot of harbors that have that sort of easy facility.
Yeah.
And quite honestly, once somebody arrives there with a plan to go to lunch at Brax or bang back a few beers at Brax or whatever they're going to do, once they're in, they're not really... I don't see people untying and taking off over a bump in the fee.
Okay, let me just remind that this is a judgment of the Waterways Committee, voted on. So, in saying that, does anyone care to make a motion?
Mr. Chair.
I have to close the open meeting. The
hearing.
Open
check
meeting.
And see if anybody wants to make a comment.
Then we may comment from the audience. Bill, you have to stand up and use the mic.
Yeah, just one comment about competitive rates. I boated for several years, and I go over to basically the Vineyard, and there it's $10 an hour.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Bill. And we're at least as attractive as a Vineyard. Jim?
Hi, Jim Chevry. I don't have a boat, but my initial reaction was that that was a low price, the $5 an hour. I really think that's low. But I was curious, how many boats on an average day during the summer or on the weekend do tie up for short term? Is it, you know, is it 5 or is it 20? Or is it more?
Sure.
Just curious.
Okay.
And then I had a follow-up.
I would say the weekends, you know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday are the big days, and on those weekends I would probably average, we probably have 8 to 10 boats that come in looking for short-term tie-up. You've been here longer than me. Would you agree with that, Heinz?
John's correct. I've been at the harbor 18 years, and these numbers of boats, very weather-dependent. Some of it's Brax, people are getting dropped off, picked up. There are people from Sage Harbor coming as well. Boater's coming in, he's got his boat insurance, his fuel, his lunch. This is just, it really is a by-thought to them as to, they're happy they get a spot, they're being escorted in, either, you know, we're talking to them or we're catching them at the time at the docks and letting them know about our rates. It would make for a little bit more organized a weekend, but just to quickly answer that, yeah, it's about 20 boats over a weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, throughout the summer.
Okay. Thank you, Heinz. Jim, you had a follow-up?
Actually, that answered it. I do think it would be interesting to know what Parker's River charges, if they charge at all, like in Yarmouth by Skippy's, and maybe Bass River Marina on the Dennis side of Bass River, okay, you know, for comparison purposes.
But maybe we can do that as a monitoring going forward.
Just interesting, but I do think that is too low. If I was coming in on a boat, I would think that I would pay more than that. I thought it was low.
Okay. Entertain a motion.
Mr. Chair, I'd move that we approve the fee recommendation on the short-term tie-up rates.
I did close the hearing. Oh, no, I didn't. I'm sorry. I need to close the hearing.
He's getting old.
They're going to fire me.
Are we closed? Take your your gavel. I move that we approve the recommended short-term tie-up rates by the Waterways Committee.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any more discussion? Anyone here or in the audience? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Thank you, John.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Moving on then to item B under public hearings and presentation. This is a presentation for the Middle School Repurposing Committee. Larry Brophy, who chairs that committee, will give us the committee's recommendations.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Selectmen. And goodbye to two of you, I guess. Good luck. Good evening. My name is Larry Brophy, and I'm here tonight to report to you the findings of the Harwich Middle School Repurposing Committee. The committee was organized by the Board of Selectmen last August. We met in early September, had a meeting to make up the committee. We elected officers and started our work. Since that time, the committee has met virtually every 2 weeks, more or less, since then. I think approximately 15 times. We've had two public meetings, issued an RFP. We received results for the RFP. 7 responses, interesting. We've received numerous public presentations and submissions. On April 27th of this year, the committee approved by a 3-2 vote a motion to set a priority of 3 recommendations to the Board of Selectmen. These 3 recommendations are as follows. Number 1, these are in order of priority. The town should retain ownership of the property and the existing buildings and further explore the use of the buildings as a town entity in combination with community uses expressed by nonprofit groups within the RFI. This action should include, yet not be limited to, the exploration of the sale of other town buildings presently occupied as to offset the cost and encourage consolidation of town properties. My emphasis added. Number 2, the town should retain ownership of the property and further explore the demolition of portions or all of the buildings. The committee has solicited estimates to achieve removal of the buildings, yet has not, to date, explored the final use of open space, i.e. the sports field, the grass, the green space, additional parking, and the use of the elementary school. And number 3 is the reissuance of an RFI for the purpose of constructing housing on the site. The committee has reviewed the current proposals for housing and have concerns on matters pertaining to funding, percentage of affordable units versus market, the impact of any development in that it needs to address certain housing needs, such as workforce units and starter homes for young Harwich residents. The committee also feels it would be a disservice to the town to proceed with one respondent, given the value of the buildings and the property. I'd like to report that the committee was in unanimous consensus. However, I cannot. The committee heard testimony on many issues. We've heard from a variety of potential users, both for-profit and not-for-profit. We've heard from housing developers, from residents, from various interest groups, and from neighbors on both the pro and cons of usage for the housing and for other uses, and the advantages of demolition. We have had a variety of reports, both on the negative and positive. In fact, there's no clear-cut use that clearly is above all others. The results of the committee vote are also indicative and follow the opinion of most of the information that we heard, relatively split, and that's reflected in a 3-2 vote. That is, there's no clear-cut winner emerging. There could be a lack of clarity on some of the ultimate uses that also emerges with the cost of retaining, demolition, and or disposition of housing. Resultantly, the committee considered both the benefits and the burdens of each of the options. It would seem the committee has reached a point where additional comment on either revenue or expenses would be more of speculation than anything. If the town chooses to retain the property, we would request the Board of Selectmen authorize a review, a professional review that is, of both the cost of development for the Harwich Middle School, the potential revenue derived from various uses, and we would request the small study be done by a consultant to determine how much the building needs renovation and the range of costs to renovate. The consultant should also look at the full cost of ownership, including operations and maintenance. This study could include an estimate of demolition costs, should include an estimate of demolition costs. Further, the cost of the elimination of a shared septic system could be reviewed to determine the savings to the Monomoy School District. That's a critical portion of the study, I think. Given the potential total cost of renovation and reuse, this small investment would eliminate the guesswork and provide many of the answers that were requested by the town meeting. I mean, I heard them. I think a number of people heard the very same things for quite a while at the town meeting. And as a result, that would be the recommendation of the board, the recommendation from the committee to the board. Yeah. And if you've got any questions, I'd be delighted.
Questions or comments, Peter?
Thank you and your board for their efforts. We know there's been a lot of diversity of opinions, if you will, and you know a lot of folks that are not shy about putting out their ideas as to what should happen.
I did notice that.
Yeah, me too. But ultimately, it comes down to not only just coming up with ideas for the building, but also, as I would call it, put meat on the bones. And you know, you're starting to address that. Really, should talking about that now, and that is trying to define let's say you're going to keep it for community use or municipal use, you know, what does the building ultimately look like? How is it configured? What's it cost? Blah, blah, blah. And what do you get out of it? So I guess my question is, do you think your committee wants to stay engaged in this process, assuming we go forward with, you know, with some form? Not that we have money sitting around to do this. It may have to be something that has to wait for an action at a town meeting or something. Does your committee want to stay in business, basically, maybe expand itself and some membership and whatnot, or does your committee want to submit the report and say to the Board of Selectmen, okay, we've taken it this far, now we'd like you to take it and figure out what to do with it for the next steps? I don't know if you've had any discussions with your committee members about that or what your feelings are about that.
Well, I was a soldier when I was very young. I was told never to volunteer. Sometimes you should volunteer, and sometimes I did. My opinion is that I think we would like to follow through. I would not like to see you have to go through the addition of a third committee. I'd like to be able to follow through and find some answer to it. I mean, it's a little different for me than it is for a lot of members from Harwich. It's an emotional issue. I didn't go to school there. You know, the elementary school I went to was built in 1892, and it's still working. Not as a school, thank God. But I would like to see the end of it. I think the committee would like to see an end one way or the other, whether it be retained by the town, whether it be knocked down, or whether it be used for housing. I would like to see the end of it.
Excuse my lack of knowledge here, but you know, your committee currently has 5 individuals, is that right?
The committee is 5 individuals. It will reduce itself to 4 tomorrow night.
I understand. But is it authorized at 5 or is it authorized at something more?
Is it 7?
I'll answer the question. It's authorized to be 7, and it expires on the 30th of next month.
Okay. All right. So ideally, you would add 3 new members at least, you know, not knowing what, you know, your other 4 members, if they want to continue on or not, if that was the...
That would be correct.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I think we need... If you're going to go forward with the amount of work I think that needs to be done, you need to expand the committee. I mean, and as you know, that's volunteers, right?
I haven't felt a knife in my back from Mr. Lean yet, but I suspect that's possible.
Okay. Linda?
I'd like to go back to, before we start deciding where we're going, but go back to the scope of what the committee was supposed to be accomplishing.
Mm-hmm.
And I have it here. We passed it on June 30th, 2014. So this is the scope that was passed and given to the middle, this round 2 of the Middle School Repurpose Committee. And item number 4, develop a comprehensive list of potential uses for this site, including advantages, disadvantages, revenues, and expenses for each use. Present this information to the Board of Selectmen before proceeding to additional actions. Have you done that yet? Because right now you're telling us you've made some votes as to what the priorities should be. However, where is the justification for those votes, the pros, the cons, the revenues, the expenses? And I understand this won't be Nat's eyelash, but I mean, clearly, I would have assumed that you all would have put some of that together. So can you comment on that? I mean, we're talking about, you know, your comment is basically from the committee, retain ownership of the property, and it sounds like at any cost. So what is the cost to retain the property and to actually go through the renovations? Has that been done yet? Have you put any, like, ranges on that? I understand that, you know, you'd have to get, if you put out an RFP to say we're going to demolish the building, then what comes back is a real number, and then you go to town meeting, et cetera, et cetera. But that was item 4 on this list. And what I'm hearing back from the committee is, without doing an RFP, which is the actual request for proposal, you're already telling us the answer. I'm finding that I'm confused. I'm confused a lot, Larry.
Hmm.
So can you, like, comment on that? Where is the meat to the bones of these 3? And this is a vote of the committee as opposed to RFPs or anything else. So how did you get there? Have you done those relative revenues, expenses, pros, cons, et cetera? Have you listed any of that? Because I would have expected that would have come with this report, and it has not. Not to put you on the spot.
Oh, that's a fun question to answer. We did develop somewhat of a list. However, these were order of magnitude numbers, mm-hmm. and the committee didn't feel comfortable presenting order of magnitude numbers that hadn't been vetted, that were estimates. Order of magnitude, exactly. That's exactly what they were. It did show the pros and the cons, and it did show some of a range of costs that might be indicative of development. However, the committee did not feel comfortable proceeding forward with these.
But you felt comfortable giving us priorities?
They did.
The committee on a 3-2 vote without backing that up. So I'm just a little confused about that. And I mean, I understand that they would have been ranges.
We'll address that for a moment.
They would have been ranges, but.
I think he answered it by saying that the committee felt it was beyond our scope to come up with numbers without getting.
It's not beyond your scope. It's in your scope of the committee charge. Well,
we felt that we couldn't come up with the numbers without getting some professional numbers, which would be hiring somebody, which would be a decision of the Board of Selectmen.
But you've still given us your priorities, because I take it you're one of the 3.
I am.
But you've given us your priorities.
Our list of recommendations.
Without doing any additional work.
We gave you a list of recommendations.
Priorities, it says right here,
in order
priorities.
In order of priority.
Yeah, priorities.
Yeah, in order of priority. And we gave them to you basically to give further direction. And it was my understanding after last meeting, this was a report to give to you.
Yeah.
To decide where to go from here.
Right. And so let me follow to be clear then. Forget the priority item per se. Your next step then is to whether hire a consultant, do something to gather it. Mike, you can stay there. One of you. The next step is to get the information to back these up on, so we can get a cost benefit analysis type discussion. Because this doesn't include this. This includes a perceived benefit, but not the cost side. But your recommendation is to fill that gap. Am I correct?
We're going to need, yes. Okay. Help to get to that point.
Right.
Is it to get information on what somebody would build there? Because, I mean, that would only come from an RFP. Or is it only to get the information on the town retaining the property and perhaps either reusing it for whatever, which I don't see defined here either, or the concept of demolishing the buildings?
Okay.
So what is this, what exactly is it you're looking to do on this information gathering? And I guess another question would be, to throw another one out there, would it be possibility to have this information get, because I do think we need to understand the cost of renovating the building, because it's anywhere from a lot of money to a whole lot of money.
Somewhere in that range, it would appear.
Yeah. I mean, anybody who does cost, does construction, it's at least 150 bucks a square foot to do any kind of work on an old building. And at 60,000 square feet, I think we can all do the math here. It's a lot of money. It's like a ton of money. And if we do it ourselves as a town, it's prevailing wage, which is even more money.
40% more money.
It's like 30 to 40% more money. So there's a lot of money here. So is the committee considering that we have to do that first and then do an RFP? Because the town hasn't voted to do anything yet, but yet you're telling us that's the priority.
Then we'll give you time to think about that, and actually you can ask the question.
I'm a little disappointed, Larry.
Jump right in, Mr.
Sorry, Larry. I'm a little disappointed because I can understand having difficulties getting to a real tight number, but I think with the 6 months you've had, you sure as hell could have done the kinds of things that Linda's done to provide a range. But that's not where my concern is. There are three recommendations here, and other than it being, this is what I recommend, there's no because. I recommend it because, what are the causes? Why did the people who vote for this vote for that priority listing? Because there's got to be, if you voted for it in a priority, you had to like it for some reason. What are the reasons? We're not given any reasons. Do you have a reason? a rationale? I mean, I can use rationale for a reason. It's easy.
Mr. Chairman, through to you, to Angelo. We heard from a number of people, both on the pros and cons of all of the processes. The difficulty then becomes to try to balance between them. I think the result that you see is the result that the committee felt prioritized it. How we get further on, it's interesting. We could do a study. We could use the method just suggested. You could do an RFP. You could do two RFPs and get real numbers. I'd like to tell you that I have an answer to it. I don't, because it seems that the vote of the committee, what we heard, and how the town meeting reacted are all pretty much something that I really can't give you an exact answer on who wants what when. Obviously, the people that are most concerned are the people that we see most often. And probably that's the very same situation that you see. And I'd like to say that we have a direct answer. There's no direct answer that we found. Mr. Chairman, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, it seems that the difficulty is not the mechanism of getting the cost estimates we're asking for. The difficulty is reaching consensus on where we want to go.
Correct.
And my, I guess our question then is that we should decide, needs decided here, is what's the next step to try to reach that consensus on where we want to go? Is it extending the committee? Will you continue to rehash the old points and not move forward? Do we need to hire a consultant and try to put in their hands together the best information then come back to people? Do we need to throw it to the next Board of Selectmen? That's a question I would have on what's the next step to move us ahead.
I'm always reluctant to say hire a consultant since I worked as one for years. I know what they do and what they cost. But to move to hire a consultant and to go through the process, you know, again, you're faced with time constraints with town meeting, and you're faced with dollar constraints at some point in time, whether it be wastewater or whether it be the school system, whatever. There's not an unlimited supply of dollars in the town. I'd like to give you a quick answer, but that's, I don't know that that's my place.
Chris, now I get to you, Peter. Let me ask Chris to weigh in on this, because I think you've had some experience in your past.
I'm like being put on the spot.
Thank you.
I didn't tell him I was going to do this to him. But.
Yeah, you know, I think it's interesting just kind of thinking about, you know, this. And the one thing I think the board really needs to take into mind is that I think that we need to try to establish a consensus as to where we're going. I think we need to understand, what does the Board of Selectmen seek to accomplish? What do the neighbors actually would like to see on that site? And then ultimately, the ultimate question for any of this is, what's going to be palatable for town meeting? Mm-hmm. Yep. And so I think that some of the work that's been done has been towards that end of, you know, let's figure out.
Agreed.
I mean, we can spend, I'm sure, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars doing feasibility studies, but to what end? I mean, until the purpose question can be kind of determined of what's going to be palatable for the community, in a larger sense, the community, I think that's really the first question that needs to be answered. And I think tonight, you've got a little sense for what that answer is. So, you know, from my perspective, I think that would be the next logical step.
Okay. Peter, you have a comment?
I guess, Larry, what I was expecting from the committee, when you talk about retain the building for municipal use or community use, whatever you want to call it, that there would have been at least a schematic floor plan, basically, of the two floors of the school that said, I'm making this up, trust me, oh, someone said we need a daycare center, so this first floor of this corner is a daycare center. Oh, we need a incubator for a start businesses or something, so this section, this wing is going to be that, and stuff like that, that would then, I think, it would be possible, at least for scoping purposes. I think the town engineer could help us, and maybe you, Mr. Town Administrator, could help us in at least scoping out what it might take to make that building do that. And then come back and say, okay, based on those things, we could have all those things in that little building. And again, I'm making it up, but you know, $4, $5, $6, $8, $10 million later, that's what we got. Town meeting, do you want that or not? I don't know. But right now, people say municipal use, I think we heard as a rumor, and then came back to us, said, oh, we need to move town hall down there. And I don't think this board, at least so far, has said that we need any more town hall. I mean, I think I was pretty clear that my opinion is, you give us more room, we're gonna grow government. So if someone was thinking about using town hall as an anchor for that building, much like a shopping center, I guess that's one thing to think about. That's certainly not where my head is at the moment. I guess I could be convinced. But someone needs to say what would go on other than just saying someone's going to play basketball or on Tuesday nights we could do this. It's got to be well thought out and say these are the activities that would happen. And by the way, these are the facilities we need to allow this to happen. And by the way, it needs, you know, two people there as full-time staff, whatever it is. I don't know what the numbers are, but I think intelligent people can sit down and figure that out. I guess the question is that something your committee can take on or would be willing to take on? Or do you just want to come back and say, well, okay, we need a consultant. And we don't have any funding for a consultant, quite frankly, at the moment.
Let me, Larry, you want to say that now or you want to take on more?
I'll take them all on at once.
Ed?
Well, I think what Peter said is partially right. You know, it would.
Partially.
Would,
right. There you go.
Partially.
Well, it you know, having a little bit more concrete idea of a possible scenario and whether it's the final mix or not, who knows? But you need to have some program of use so you can do the part where he says get some idea of what the cost of rehabbing it would be. But also you need the program of use, and this is the part that I think is of concern of neighbors and parents at the elementary school, is what is that going to mean in the day-to-day operation and traffic patterns and general uproar around the site. You know, if you have a recreation program and some classes and a town hall, how much traffic is that going to be bringing in and out? Because we know traffic with the elementary school is a problem. You know, and those, I think, are probably those sorts of, I don't know if you call them quality of life issues, are probably more important in terms of people, especially in the neighborhood, but the parents with the elementary school are more interested in finding out to determine whether they would support one thing or another, whether that's housing or whatnot. You know, none of the proposed uses are without their impact in the neighborhood, and really the only potential use that would sort of dovetail nicely as a neighbor with a school is another school, because they tend to be on the same schedule and you can tweak them a little bit, so you know the different schools are a half hour off, so you don't have everybody showing up at once to pick it up. But if you set up the building to have some meeting space, and a meeting lets out at 2:30 when all the parents are showing up to pick up their kids, you've got a nightmare on your hands, you know. So those are the sorts of issues that I think we need to detail out to get to the point where we have consensus on which way the town wants to go. It's right now, if you put out, say, an RFP for housing, given how speculative the potential of getting approval at town meeting is, I think would significantly impair the number of and the quality of RFPs you get, because serious firms are looking at probably less than a 50-50 shot of getting approval at town meeting, and are they going to drop the $30,000 or $40,000 into preparing a competitive RFP? Probably not.
I think that last point is one of getting back to Chris's point, where we need additional discussion on consensus building. You know, there's some compromise that provides, that reaches that, and you're right, unless we get that there at that committee, we have no chance, we have any chance to do anything at town meeting unless we reach consensus with this group. Linda?
I have been going to most of these meetings, sitting in the audience, listening, and I think that, you know, Peter and Ed, you're right, I have heard that the phrase that gets used is, keep the property for municipal use. And or mixed use, but there hasn't been any real development of what that means. There also hasn't been enough discussion to me as to who would do that, because having, as Peter's example, this corner is the daycare center and this corner is this and this floor over here, this corner is that, that's all well and good. Who's going to manage that process? I think we also have to consider, does the town want to be in the position of becoming landlords? I mean, we can't even take care of what we have, let alone we'd have be taking care of tenants. I don't even want to think about that. But how would that be managed? How would that process happen? You know, if somebody wants to put an RFP together that says, you know, I will take on the response of this building and I will get blah, blah, blah in there, great. It's mixed use. And we could, you know, then we retain the gym for whatever. But I'm still looking for the meat on the bones here. And I haven't seen that, and it's clearly not in this report.
Angela?
I think we need to start from the beginning. I think what the beginning is what do we want there? What does the community want there? And the community is more than just the abutters. It's called the town of Harwich. Because until we can come up with what we want there, we're going to be going around in circles. The schools have been very clear. They're never going to add on to that building, they say, because if there aren't any more kids showing up, but also they do it in Chatham. And they don't see a concern with that building impacting our building, the middle school, impacting on the elementary school for practically any item that has come up. And that's where they come from. And I would think they would understand that. We also know we've got another year to go to make the decision, because this is going to have to be brought to town meeting. And I don't see a town meeting showing up in September. So one of my requests to you, Chris, is to, and I know you've worked it through once, but you can, sorry, is right now we have the building partially open because of you're trying to balance insurance costs versus other things to keep the total cost down. Let's double check to find out if that is still the best way to do it, or we close the doors, lock it up, and we can make it look like the, you know, Bank Street Firehouse or the West Harwich thing, because that's what we do typically, and spend the year looking for answers. I don't think we can just, you know, unless, you know, having it over to the gym and whatnot is less expensive. And if we can save the money you have budgeted for that, like just closing it, we can then probably take that money to hire a consultant or people who could set up focus groups with the people in town to understand our needs. I mean, we have a letter in our packet explaining a whole set of needs in terms of Council on Aging people, or I should say, you know, older people. So that's important. Unless the building won't work unless it's solving a need. Let's find out what we need. We don't need another gym, I don't think. Chris?
Just to, you know, under the charter, my responsibility is try to, you know, control the assets and do what makes sense. And, you know, a couple ways to pursue that has been done is, for insurance purposes, if we have some utilization, then it's not technically a vacant building. We don't get into the vacant building coverage. The second one that we have explored with the school is to look at the septic system. That septic system is $40,000 for operation of the plant. If the consumption or the amount of materials going into that doesn't warrant it, then we should decommission that and make it into a septic system. Right now, the primary user of that is the school department. So Monomoy has been requested to see about changing that into a less extensive use to try to diminish the cost. My significant concern, and I was the one that had originally said that we should have the carrying costs on there, once that building gets mothballed, the amount of potential use for it will significantly decrease. And you will not be able to actively market that. There will be mold through it. You'll be creating an environmental hazard. So I know the carrying costs, and certainly, you know, I'm the guy that puts together the budget. So to say that, you know, we want to spend $250,000, you know, the second, you know, $125,000 a year for 2 years, you know, life would be a heck of a lot easier if we don't have to do that. And certainly I understand that. But I think that, you know, one thing too to keep in mind, I tried to sell 5 buildings in the last place. I was fairly successful. I got 3 of them basically sold. The one thing that we need to understand in government is who are our partners that are in the private sector that want this building? And we don't have a lot of people that lined up. We did an RFP that was fairly broad scoped. Whoever wants to come forward, please come forward with a plan. Tell us what works. We had one, mm-hmm. Affordable housing. That didn't go over in the community. So I think the board needs to really seriously think about, you know, what is going to be palatable. And, you know, maybe one of the things that's palatable is, you know, let's diminish some of our losses. Seriously consider, I look at that site and I see an elementary school who is inappropriate to that area. It's too big for the site that it's on. So that's a real concern, and in terms of preserving you know, the use for the town, you know, one concept would be to demo portion of the building or the entirety of the building, reserve it as the selectmen's, you know, under general municipal control. Because I have been in other towns when 20 years later, somebody came forward and said, well, we need that space. And we were able to convert that space into back into municipal use. So, you know, I've been doing this for a long time and you see these different trends. But, you know, I think that last RFP, the first group, you know, had a broad range approach, and yet only one proposer came forward. And unless other people are going to come forward with alternative school uses or what have you, you know, we need to seriously consider if it's going to be retained as a town asset, what's the best way to retain that without having the taxpayers footing a bill for just maintaining a status quo.
Now, Linda?
I would say that probably all makes sense, except in order to use that building and change the use, it's my understanding that we have to bring it up to code. There's ADA issues over there that have to be brought up to code. It needs all new windows, which has been understood for a while. There's a ton of stuff over there that needs to be done. So the concept that we're just going to open the doors and have it for general use and see if people kill themselves over there, that's probably not a good idea either. I mean, it's not so simple as the building is old. Yes, I know some of us went to school there, et cetera, but the building is old. And so at what point do you, and is it even, on a different tack, is it even appropriate to use as a school anymore? We just knocked down Harwich High School and built a new high school because it was determined that it was not a modern building. Can that building at this point, would that be acceptable as a school? Not clear, because it doesn't have, well, number one, doesn't have air conditioning. It doesn't have this, it doesn't have that. There's a ton of work that to turn that into a school. And that's a ton of dollars too. So, I mean, overall, I think that if anybody's going to use this building for something, yes, I think we should come up with the cost of what it would be to renovate for office space or this or that. That's a reasonable number to have because I think it's going to be a big number. It's not going to be like $200,000 and call it a day. I mean, anybody who thinks that is, you know, they're not thinking about it. Apparently the elevator needs work. Does anybody have any idea what an elevator costs? A couple hundred thousand dollars just for the elevator.
Each.
I mean, so there's just a huge amount of costs over there, and even if 20 years from now somebody says, geez, we could use that space, it's going to be inadequate anyways. Because it's going to be so out of code.
Just to be clear, the first word I said was demolish.
Yes.
Either all or sections of it and retain the land as general municipal use. A lot of times, and your point's well taken, when you have an old building that becomes dysfunctional, you have to, it's, sometimes it's cheaper to just build new. So retain the land so you have that option. One of the things about moving town hall, I mean, the board did ask me to weigh in on this. And, you know, I can't see taking an 18,000 square foot building that we are looking at. We've already relocated one office to the community center. We're looking at moving the records over to the community center. And we'll come back with other ideas to try to make this building work for the foreseeable future. So I don't think, you know, moving town hall is really that viable, you know, of an option. So at least from my perspective as town administrator, I mean, I think see what other potential uses there are. And as we've already heard, if we're going to do recreation doesn't pay for itself. So if it's going to be a community center, it needs to be understood that that's something that's going to be an additional cost and going to provide
every
a benefit
year
to the community without being a revenue source for us.
Thank you. Any other there you wish to weigh in on this?
I certainly agree with Chris 100%. We looked at alternatives for use of the building as the town hall. I mean, in the grander scheme of things, yes, you could put 18,000 square feet into 72,000, and in the fullness of time, you'd fill it. And it's going to cost some money, make no mistake about it, and the traffic would be far worse than it ever was with the middle school. We did look at those alternatives, and To answer a couple of your questions, yes, I agree with the because we should have an answer for it. The traffic has to be answered. We'd love to sit down and make a plan that, you know, that the daycare center can go here and the 3D thing can go there and the partnership school can go there. We've been told by the school district that they don't want to use it as a school again, period. It's too old. And I can't see them having a competitor there for a variety of reasons. You might not want a partnership school right beside your a charter school right beside your elementary school, and it would only increase traffic. So really what you want to do is get, if we take the priority list and say it's going to cost this range to do this range to knock it down, or this range for somebody else to do it, it gives you a range of options and how to get there. That's the only question. But I think the priorities that we've given you are the ones that that we've heard over the last several months from a variety of people. There's no question, you know, there's some uses that are higher priority than others. Everybody has their own different opinion, but those three uses, there's no question at all that with variations it's covered. How you make that choice, I don't know, but it's going to cost a lot of money to bring it up to code. It's the elevators are out, ADA is out, most of the systems are gone, the sprinkler system wouldn't work, the bricks have to be repointed, the roof is good outside of that, it's a fine building. But yeah, the insulation's actually pretty good. But
thank you, Larry. Is there any other
that summarizes it.
Please use the mic, and then we'll Jim first, and then this we'll get back there.
I don't know why I haven't come to more of these.
They're fun, aren't they?
You're having a good time, aren't you?
We're overthinking it. It's too close to the elementary school to be used for much of anything. I think that if you try to put housing in there, the elementary school parents will go rabid. I think that you cannot use it as it is because it will cost too much money to bring it up to code, to make the necessary repairs, to use it as a municipal piece of property as it is. I think the town administrator is hitting it right on the head. Because of the close proximity to the elementary school, it's basically part of that area. There's a lot of houses right in that area. It's sandwiched right in that whole spot. I think really the best solution to save money, stop the bleeding, whatever word you want to use, because municipal use is never going to work. Housing will never fly. I think that really knock it down, make it open space, make maybe a park if you want, make it look nice, and keep it there for any eventual use. As the town administrator said, if someone comes along and if the town grows and we say, hey, we want to put something there, well, it's there. And it is easier to build new than it is to renovate. So I think we're really overthinking it.
Okay. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Barry Knowles from South Harwich. I'd just like to make some general suggestions. I think it would be wise to extend the current repurpose committee and expand it to the full 7 members, and try to get some of these questions answered. I think the septic is still unclear whether that is going to be able to be shared if something is used there. Demolition costs, we've got to get a figure for that. Housing costs, I think if it's going to ever go for housing, we need to tweak that and see if, in fact, the town could use part of the building and housing could be part and so on. There's a lot of questions, but if this new committee could work with the town engineer, the health agent, and possibly a consultant, first you'd have to find out what that would cost. Certainly it's not an open-ended financial thing. Maybe we could really get somewhere, because now everybody's throwing out their opinions, but we still don't have the specifics.
Yeah.
And so that's my, I guess, everything. But also traffic. We've got, I think, maybe a separate subcommittee on traffic, this middle school, the elementary school traffic is a major issue. And I don't think that just keeping this building is going to solve that. We've got to find another way. I understand this year it became huge because one student at a time is now dismissed. And so maybe meeting with the elementary school administration, the school committee, the parents, something else could be worked out. And so those are some of my suggestions.
Okay, thank you, Barry. Linda?
Just a comment on the school thing. The elementary school and David Spitz, the principal there, worked out a way to make that road that goes, you know, through the middle school property into the elementary school, make it one way, and the cars line up two by two like Noah's Ark. It has taken all the traffic out, and it seems from all reports to be working just fine. So they have found some solutions to some of this, and the parents apparently have been quite good about getting in their lines, and then they move forward, pick up their children, and they move on out. So that there have been, you know, in the committee's defense, they have met at least once or twice with the elementary school principal. They've had conversations with the school people. So at least this two by two and the path and the one way seems to be working.
Well, I was aware of that. However, that's dependent on using the current middle school property.
Right.
And it precludes a lot of other uses. So there might be some other solutions.
But I mean, you could change
the possibility of hiring an aide so that more than one student could be released at a time, things like that can be looked into. Because this is not, you know, I can't see retaining this whole property just for traffic.
Okay, thank you, Barry. Peter?
Just quickly, one of the best things we've done in this town as far as revenue generation in the last several years is the solar installation in the landfill.
Sure.
If you talk about knocking down this facility, I'm hearing there's 16 acres there. Let's make a solar field. Huh? All right. Somebody ought to do an estimate on how many solar panels you can put on there, what we could generate for revenue if we turn it into a sun field with a road to get to the elementary school.
There you go.
Okay. Richard?
Hi, Richard Gunderson, Harwich. A lot of the conversation is similar to what we heard at the special town meeting. There were a number of serious objections by abutters, by parents, by a whole group of people on what the first proposal came in proposing. It was an ugly, large development, and I don't think anybody really, in retrospect, wanted that kind of a development. But it woke people up to paying attention to this project, and I do think it got a few active minds going. And as Linda just mentioned, the principal of the school and the town planner, along with a few policemen, decided that they could maybe re-educate some of the parents on how to get in and out without necessarily causing a backup onto Sisson Road. It works. That still can happen. The new RFP, if there is one, could specify that continue somewhere on the 6 acres, roughly, of parcel which would be designated to go with the building. It's not 14 or 18, it's determined to be about 6. The ball fields don't go with it. So all these issues came up over and over, and they've been put through the media over and over and magnified. Joint septic system, ball fields, traffic, children's safety, drug and alcohol abuse by older people, sex offenders. We've heard it all. I have, and I didn't attend all the meetings. These poor guys heard it every night. So some of those things are still real in the mind of many people, but they're not and shouldn't be showstoppers for the development of this property. The issues are getting smaller. They're still big, but they're getting smaller. If you went forward with an RFP, there might be some bidders out there who know how to handle a traffic design to segment, separate the traffic to the residential site, let's call it a residential or multi-purpose use, to the right, to the east side, the west side toward South Street is designated for parent traffic only. You've separated the two. They can come and go as they want to. There is no simultaneous confusion. I mean, there are ways of solving this. The fact that it wasn't solved on Sisson Road for years, I can't explain why. But there is a simple solution, and it seems to work. So anyway, I believe the issues are getting narrower. I think this committee made progress. I think there is a large amount of information that doesn't exist. Nobody really believes what you can look up on another project somewhere in the internet, because it's not that specific building. So they're always going to say, that's a generalization. That's a summary that doesn't make sense for our particular building. So if you do want to use that, those numbers, I think you do need somebody to go in and survey specifically what the building is inside and come up with a, yeah, this needs to be totally gutted, or it doesn't need to be totally gutted, or it can be demolished partially or not. So there are things outside that I've observed that this committee is not capable of doing. I don't know too many people in the townsfolk that are willing to do it or are capable of doing it. So you do need some professional help if you're ever going to be able to answer the specific questions, such as those that came up at the special town meeting. There were people there who said, would this be a break even if we went for this mixed use cultural purpose? I don't know how you come up with that if you don't have good costs of what that building is going to cost to renovate and operate over time, cost of ownership. I don't know how you come up with potential uses. I mean, you could come up with an infinite number of a variety of placements and architecture within that 70,000 square foot building. So I think you really need to look at it more from a conceptual viewpoint. What would we gain by leasing the whole building? Could somebody ever lease it? Could we manage it? I think you can come up with the pros and cons on a lot of those things and say, no, we don't want to manage it. So if you can't use the building as a whole for some mixed use, commercial, or some housing, then you probably should demolish it. But I think it'd be a terrible waste of a good building. Anyway, I would hope you would continue the committee or some substitutes for the committee. I think they're heading in the right direction. I hate to bring the bad news, but there are schools out there that took 30 years to get to their final decision. Most of them, it takes several years. I mean, the one in Bourne right now is going into its third year of extending a P&S agreement with the company that bid on our school the first time. It could take a while. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Any other comments? This was meant to be a report. We're not deciding anything tonight. I think our if a decision is made, it's really well, it's where to go next. And I think I'm hoping the agreement is to the committee continues on to respond to the questions that have come out during these discussions, both from board members and the audience and the town meeting. And I would further suggest that you lean possibly even more heavily on Chris and your crew than before to get the town engineer and town planner and people involved on conceptual ideas and any help you can get to do more. The public meeting is always hard to get people to come to. And how do you get that, expand that beyond the immediate neighborhood to the town as a whole, I think is critical as well. But unless I hear objection, I think we've heard it. And the thing is to, more volunteers can put your committee, as Peter said, and continue on.
Maybe you could volunteer for the committee, Mr. Chairman.
There you go. Great idea.
His wife would kill him.
Peter?
Could I just ask Larry, do you think it would be fair if we said to you, could you and your committee come back with at least what your short-term plan is as a committee, you know, maybe 6 or 8 weeks from now? I mean, you know, is your plan, gee, we're coming up with some concepts on how do you know, what the building might be used for, or, I mean, I just heard the chairman say we'll keep answering questions and whatnot. I'm not sure that takes the ball down the court at all. You know what I mean? How do we get some meat on this bone?
And I would, and I'm not sure I'd want to go 6 to 8 weeks, you know.
Well, whatever it is. I mean, if we're going to add three more bodies, he's going to be short one. Mike's coming on board here tomorrow, and mm-hmm. So there's a hole. So he's got to add at least that plus two more. So it behooves us to get him three more bodies so he's got a full committee. So then, they can, because the work has to be distributed, no doubt about it, but you got to figure out what the work is going to be.
And also it's, while we could potentially knock the buildings down and keep it as space for use in 20 years. I will personally bet everybody in this room $100 that after the buildings are down and it's nice green space, I'll bet everybody in this room $100 that the town would never build anything on that again, because we're taking away open space, we're taking away park. So the concept that we're going to knock the buildings down and leave it in case we need it for something else, $100, everybody in this room. My husband's sitting in the audience and he's counting that up.
It's his $100.
And he's shaking uncontrollably.
It's his $100.
Right, and it's his $100, so I don't care.
Well, you have a gentleman behind you. You want to speak as well?
Yes,
because I'm about ready to close this,
thank you.
This topic.
Good evening, Gary Curro. I was just wondering, who has the final say as to what happens with the property? Is it the Selectmen or
town meeting?
Town meeting?
Yeah.
Okay.
The committee makes recommendations to the board. We make recommendations to town meeting.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Barbara Ann, one more, will you?
Just a quick suggestion. There's groups out there like SCORE and some of the other business-focused groups. Perhaps we could reach out to those people that you're talking about trying to get numbers. We don't have any money to get consultants. But there's professionals that are retired that have done this for a kajillion years. Could we perhaps be in a focus mode and try and get some of those people who crunch dollars and cents with building or whatever you're looking for, and get them on the committee, so that you've got these folks that have done great work that got started and you're looking for numbers to get added? We don't need more people who don't have that experience. You need people who do have something that can help them move further down the road to get our town some kind of numbers, so that you can come back and say, okay, is it A, B, or C? And A costs this, B costs this, and C costs this. What do you want, people? Vote for it. We can't do that right now because we don't have any of those numbers. But maybe an organization like that, or another one where they're all volunteers and they do have years of experience and they're retired people in those fields.
I think that's a good idea. Yeah. Chris, are you listening to that? Because that might be a place to get some expertise.
I've used SCORE in the past, in past towns. You know, one of the things, just a suggestion to the board, you know, you have a committee that's done a lot of legwork, and maybe to Peter's point, I mean, they have a charge that ends on June 30th. Why not ask the committee to submit their recommendation for what the next 6 months should be, what the next step in the process should be, so the board can weigh out. I mean, they have sat for two times a month to sit there and get, why not ask them for how do we continue to move this thing forward?
Angela?
One of the concerns I have with numbers is that if you want to be an accountant and take it to three decimal places, it takes a lot of money. If you want to get an estimate, you can do that. You can get close to what you're dealing with the numbers we have right now. We had somebody who wanted to buy it for us that gave us a number. And let's assume we take that as the valuation for the building so we know how much tax we would get. So that's the positive side. And that's the end of that process, because that's all you get out of that process is the tax money and whatever he pays for it. And then we run a community center. We have the cost of that down to a large, right down in the recs. You can figure out that you probably don't want to run another community center very quickly. So I think we can get a range of numbers that says demolition is, because we can ask them, people, is X dollars, this is Y, and this is whatever. And you know the numbers aren't absolutely correct, but that's the way you do finance. That's where you start. Because otherwise you start with $100,000 to get people to take it to three decimal places, and you don't need that. Just don't need it.
I'm not so convinced that we, that we can't take that crack at it. I mean, I've done that for years. It's what I do for a living. And you actually do come up with a range. If somebody says, I mean, if anybody in our community said, I want to go out and buy a new boat, John, and what do? You go out and you find some prices, but until you actually get a real cost to buy in your paws, it's a range. It's from here to here, and it's going to cost about this much from here to here. Then if you get the approval to do that, you go out and you get the actual bids, and that's the cost that you pay. I mean, it's no different than our houses. We all think our houses are worth a couple of billion dollars. The only number that matters is what somebody is willing to write you a check for. And I think that that's where some of the confusion is coming in, that these buildings are, or the property is assessed at all this money. But nobody's going to pay us all that money, because then they have to put a whole bunch more money into it, and then it becomes totally not cost effective for them. So we got to keep that in mind too. But I agree with you, Angelo. You ought to be able to go together ranges of probably. We have a ton of people who do construction in this community. They ought to be able to look at that building and say, $150 a square foot, $200 a square foot, $300 a square foot. Give you ranges. You'd at least come up with some idea of what you're talking about.
Okay, I think we've probably killed this subject. I would think, just as a closing comment, is that you've listed three possibilities or priorities. I would think in the next few weeks you could outline how you're going to get some cost benefit, some numbers and some reasons behind each of those, and come back and decide where you want to go next. I mean, you already have those targets.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
And plus a general plug for, there will be three open spots on this committee. Put in something to the town administrator. We'll talk to you.
Okay. Again, thank you, Larry, and thanks to the committee.
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen, and good luck and Godspeed to two of you.
And the hell with the rest of us.
Exactly. Okay. Moving on, that concludes that discussion. You folks can stay around, though.
Look at them bailing.
Moving on, we have no old business tonight. Moving to new business, we have requests by Coastal Engineering to accept pier ramp and float location for Peter and Lisa Hennessy. A comment on that. This was in the consent agenda. I asked it to be on the as new business, because anytime we talk about ramps, it seems to be critical. Don, I'm not sure we're going to need all that, actually. Because my comment is going to be that this has been approved already by the Conservation Commission and has been approved by Waterways.
Correct.
The only reason it's coming to us is that as it goes before the state, we're a butter, so it has to be approved by the Board of Selectmen. Sometimes it's not an appeal. It has nothing to do with that. And we don't want, the reason I mentioned you, Don, I don't want this committee to rehash what's been approved by Waterways and Conservation.
Okay.
Ours is simply to approve as an abutter. Ed?
Can I make just a comment?
Sure, you can.
We will need from the selectmen, because it's a property that's owned by the town, and the Army Corps will require a no objection from the owner that we're closer than 25 feet to the property line.
Right.
We
understand.
We got that. Thank you. Ed?
Well, Mr. Chair, knowing how extensive the review of the Waterways Commission and the Conservation Commission are in the locating of pier, docks, and floats in waterways of the town, I'd move that we approve the location as recommended by those two bodies at 637 Route 28, and also state that we have no objection to, what was the word?
Being closer than 25 feet to the property line.
Being closer to 25 feet to the property line.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Any more discussion, Peter?
Can we just, for the benefit of the folks at home, could you show us the plan? I mean, show them the plan. We've seen it, but if it's possible to get it on, you know, TV so that folks see it, just to know what it is. I mean, it's, you know, it's on Witchmere Harbor, and it's.
Front of us.
Yeah, and you can just sort of point out, you know, where the harbor is. And
the harbor.
Witchmere Harbor's here. The town property here, which is the overlook, is here. There's a float right next door. The large boat that's usually in Witchmere Harbor's over here. But in between, there's a small float here. We need to be the required 65 feet. With our float, that puts us closer than 25 feet to the property line, so we need permission from the selectmen indicating there's no objection to us being that close.
And just for clarification, this is a new dock, not a replacement dock, is that right?
Correct, it's a new proposal, yes.
Angelo?
Just for everybody's information, the conservation director was here prior to the meeting, which explained that our decision has to do with our land and how close we are to the dock, not what it looks like, not where it is. Because the last thing I want us to get involved with is doing docks, because
this is very unique.
It wants to be clear that we're not intersecting or interjecting ourselves in the Conservation Commission or waterways discussion on this.
That's why I made the motion quickly.
So,
we didn't get into that conversation.
Well, I was trying to move that on, but we got involved anyway. Was there a second?
I think I said.
Angelo, second? Any more discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, Don.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you, folks. Next item on new business is a letter to Mass DOT regarding sidewalk construction, future maintenance. Chris, you want to?
Sure, thank you, Mr. Chairman. As the board's aware, we had put together a letter asking for the state that when they go in and do renovations to their street to overlay it or what have you, would they consider expanding and adding in some spots, but mostly renovating in existing spots, approximately 3,300 feet of sidewalk. And actually, to my amazement, we got a letter back that said, yes, they are willing to do that. So when they go in and do work on that, they would be willing to put in sidewalk. There's a section of 28, I'm trying to think of the location, that they did put in some sidewalk recently. Mm-hmm. And I did ask the gentleman,
church.
He said that it had been requested and they put it in. So this would be a very, very similar project. The only thing they asked is that would the board be willing to say that we would maintain the sidewalks in terms of having a responsibility of the municipality. So we did draft a letter on the board's behalf to say that we would do that. The fact that they would come in and do this work, I think, is definitely a worthwhile project.
I agree. Ed?
They use the term Harwich Point. Where is Harwich Point?
Yeah, you know, I looked at our letter and it said Sackatucket Harbor. I don't know where he found Harwich Point. I don't know
what
where.
What does it refer to?
We actually, we're drafted it in such a way where it says Sackatucket Harbor. So I don't know where he came up with that.
We're keeping it secret. We don't want a lot of people there.
You're not suggesting it's just a typo? You think they meant something?
Well, they obviously are referring to something that they know of.
And my
concern is they're referring to the overlook. And they're going to only go that far.
Oh, okay.
Our intent is to get it all the way over to Sackatucket.
Well, I think that's what the letter says.
I did call to verify that, and he said, yeah, we meant to say whatever you had in your letter.
Okay.
So our letter was specifically for Sackatucket Harbor.
And it is 3,300 feet, which is the number we talked about before.
Correct.
And the other thing to point out, we mentioned this before when we drafted our letter requesting it, and that is, you know, there's no intent to change in the road. This is when they do maintenance on the road, which I assume to be scraping out the asphalt and, you know, repaving it, sort
right.
of thing. Yeah.
Okay. Any more discussion?
10 years from now, by the way,
right.
So
don't
expect this to happen next week.
Having said that, it'll be next Tuesday.
I don't think so.
You know,
still either.
Okay. Is there no more discussion? I entertain a motion.
Didn't need it.
You guys, no.
Well,
I don't think there was
not this one yet.
I move that we approve and send the letter.
Is there a second? Linda, second it? Other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you. Town Administrator's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do wish to just express my good wishes to yourself and to Ed as well. And appreciate, obviously, the time that I've been here to work with you during my stint where we had overlap. I know it's a difficult job to be an elected official, and I just wanted to at least personally say that I've appreciated our interaction over the time that we've been together for both of you. In terms of just a couple of other items on the police chief search, we have kind of the narrowing interviews for this Wednesday. So we are hopeful that we will have three for the board. In terms of we will have that process Wednesday. It's going to take us a little bit to get what those three are going to be. We have established a process. We're having a writing sample, so we need to email the writing sample to each of the committee members, and they'll provide feedback to me. We'll put that together, and I'll put together a package for the board. But probably something that we want to have on a future agenda with the new board. How do they want to proceed with that? Do they want to have? I mean, I would certainly encourage one open session in which the three candidates would present in front of the board. The board would defer decision, kind of hear each of the candidates, and then at the next meeting, kind of decide which one that they want to pursue. I think that does make some sense in how I've seen it done in a couple other places. And then the next one I have is on the superintendent of water and wastewater. I actually was wrong. I've been the acting water superintendent for almost a year. It's been that long. And finally, we have hired, the Water Commission has hired a gentleman by the name of Dan Pelletier, who will start on June 1st. So we have that position filled, which there's no one happier than myself that we were able to do that. And I think he's going to be a great addition. He had a lot of project management experience working for firms in which they installed not only water lines, but also sewer lines. So we do have somebody that has that diversity of background. He's not an engineer, not a PE, but he went to engineering school. So I think he has a lot of value added for the organization. So I just wanted to kind of report that we have finally got that position filled. That concludes my comments this evening, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chris. On the Selectmen's report, we discussed last time about our policy for Selectmen's rules of operations, and basically the question was that I think we all knew anyway, but 2 weeks after the elections when the Board of Selectmen reorganized, and that still holds, and the board will have two new members next week, so this is a little different than some previous times. But in terms of procession, just to be clear, Peter's been vice chair, so he'll just take over as vice chair for a meeting and then reorganize the meeting after that. So the policy continuity is assured. And so I just wanted to reinforce that tonight. Saying I don't know if we need any more discussion than that. But okay, Ed, did this or go to the Selectman's report?
Hmm? No.
Okay, Peter?
Well, no.
Ed?
I wasn't going to comment on the rules.
Okay.
But I just, again, want to indicate that it's been a good 11-year stint for me. I hope it's been a good 11-year stint for the town. One thing I do want to say is that I appreciate all the support, assistance, and information that the staff of the town have always freely given selectmen, myself, and other selectmen I know who need good advice at times, good information to do their job well. And they've been the staff of this town, I think, are committed to doing the best by our town and have been a joy to work with.
Thank you, Ed. Peter?
We'll miss you guys. That's all I can say.
Well, thank you. I'll just reiterate, I agree with Ed. Not always, but in that point, I agree. Of course. And I also say it's been, I've very much appreciated working with the rest of the board. We haven't always agreed, but if we all agreed, we only need one board member, right?
We were thinking of that.
And we were thinking of that.
It's the disagreement that is what democracy looks like.
It looks like. And, and it's been good, but we've always disagreed respectfully, and we've moved on, so that's good. And Linda and I even, as long as we get, chairperson from chairman, we'll be okay.
Honest to God, why do we have to keep saying chairman?
He got
what
to see
is
her
the
someday.
Problem with us moving these old dogs into a little more modern vocabulary? It's beyond my comprehension. Larry, middle school repurpose committee?
What about it?
Does he want to be on it?
Oh. I'll think about it.
It's been a pleasure working with you as well.
Thank you.
Thanks, Larry. Good luck.
Thank you.
And I need you to come over with your truck.
Entertaining a motion to adjourn.
So moved.